ABS is a very common engineering plastic, and so we get asked all the time whether carbon offers a material that's similar to ABS. To get into this, I have with me Ikpreet Grover, who's a senior research scientist at Carbon. Ikpreet, it's great to speak with you today.
Hi, John.
So let's begin by talking about what ABS is, what makes it great, why do people like to use it?
ABS comes from one of the family of polymers, which are known as amorphous thermoplastics. And if you can look at the screen, you would see like amorphous thermoplastics are basically these long chains of polymers, which is essentially like a full bowl of spaghetti. And the longer the chains are, the more entanglement that you see, and that gives the property set to the materials. And usually the 3D printing materials are what is looks like our thermosets, where they are cross-linked, and you get a very different set of properties from them. But coming back to understanding ABS more, it's basically a tert polymer, which means that it's a mixture of three different monomers. So it's made up of acrylonitrile, butadiene, and styrene. So on the right-hand side of the on the slide deck, you can see it has the acrylonitrile, which makes it slightly more polar and lets everything mix up pretty well. You have styrene as the component, which gives it the rigidity and makes it more stiff. It also gives it pretty high temperature performance resistance. So the more styrene you have in the formulation, the stronger and the higher temperatures it can withstand. And the main thing what is part of this is the butadiene, which is the central part of ABS, which gives it all of its high performance and high impact strength properties. So what happens is now in this ABS, you have this bulky, rigid polystyrene around it, and then you have this soft and gooey butadiene between, which acts as a cushion, and what we call it as rubber toughened domains of butadiene, which gives it its amazing set of high impact strength properties.
So it looks like you have these three components, and of course there are a lot of other additives. So there are a lot of varieties of ABS, right, with different characteristics?
Right. So the way you prepare ABS is using these three constituents, and you can vary the proportion of each one of these to make sure what kind of the end set of properties you're looking for. If you increase more of the styrene, it's going to be more rigid. It's going to have a better surface finish. It's going to be more shinier as compared to if you have more butadiene, it's going to be more tougher and can take in a lot more impact strength as well.
So let's talk about why you might use ABS, some common applications. What makes it great?
So ABS is something which we understand as an everyday use plastic. Like it's present all over in our lives. And the most best example what I like for ABS is Legos. Everybody has played with it. They look shiny, they are pretty good, they're stiff, rigid. You can throw them around, bounce on them, walk on them, and they're still pretty
painfully.
Good. They don't break painfully. Yep. And they're still pretty good. And they don't break easily. But seldom you would know that ABS is part of like probably so many of the consumer appliances as well, from your blenders to your remote TV sets to your TV cabins. It's everywhere. And even in the part of where you use it for automotive applications, it's part of your dashboard panels and a lot of small array of functional parts across the interiors of the car.
Let's talk about constraints. I mean, where would it not be a good material to use?
So typically ABS it can work around pretty well for all of us in most of the conditions, but it definitely has constraints where it's in under continuous use under stress, it can get fatigued pretty quickly, which is a disadvantage to a general, like an amorphous thermoplastics range of plastics as well. And it also has a very moderate to poor chemical resistance to most of the solvents. So that's where it's limited. But still why everybody uses it is because it is really easy to mold. It has really low shrinkage and produces very less warpage, which makes it a great end use for consumer applications so that it can provide a very good surface finish. And talking about surface finish, I would really like to introduce that most of the 3D printing processes, which are based on light-based systems, like carbon's DLS, tend to have a very high resolution for surface finish. As you can see in some of these examples, it is very easy to add textures to the surface of these parts, which can be added using the carbon software and can end up providing very better functionality for the use case scenario. That if you're holding a part and you need some more grip to it, you can add different kind of textures, and it is and you can add it on different materials as well. It is not limited to one material set. And usually adding textures in injection molding can be slightly harder.
Or impossible, right? Depending on the geometry, but at least a little bit more expensive.
Exactly.
So speaking of carbon materials, let's talk about which carbon materials might be similar to ABS or could be used in the kind of applications where you would also specify ABS.
So nowadays, a lot of people in the industry talk about materials similar to ABS. And what they usually point out to is the modulus and the elongation at break for these materials. But a property which is very critical to the applications for ABS tends to be the impact strength and the toughness it can withstand for an everyday use. And I would like to introduce you to a couple of materials from carbon, where if you look at for FPU50, which is a flexible polyurethane, it's a slightly softer material, but has a great impact resistance and fatigue resistance. But another good material which has properties very similar to ABS tends to be RPU130, which is basically a rigid polyurethane material. So RPU130 tends to be very rigid, has toughness like ABS, but also tends to provide a way more higher temperature use. And in this case, it can go up to almost 115°C for its use, which makes it a very good fit for automotive, consumer, as well as industrial applications.
So RPU130 actually has a higher HDT than ABS, right?
That's correct. And since it depends on a different chemistry, for polyurethanes, you have different kind of levers to make it more heat resistant as well. Mm-hmm. But if you look at this graph, the size of the circle denotes the tensile modulus of the material, whereas on the x-axis, you have the heat deflection temperature, which decides what temperature you can use that material at. And on the y-axis, you see is a notched Izard impact resistance, which defines how tough or impact resistant the material is. And if you see, RP130 fits very well into, as you compare it with all the other injection molding materials. It has a higher heat deflection temperature than ABS, has a really good, really high notched Izard impact strength as well, which is very similar to other injection molded materials like ABS. But what you really need to understand over here is that no one material is going to be exactly similar to ABS. And it depends on the application as to what you're really looking for and where the end use of the material is going to be.
Right, so it's important in this case, it's not a matter of just looking at a table and seeing that carbon or some other 3D printing vendor says this material is ABS-like, right? It's about considering your application and your needs, thinking about why you're specifying ABS, and then applying that to a material selection.
Right, understanding the process and why you need the material is the most critical part.
But RPU130 was released just last year. It's a really exciting new material, and it's opened up a ton of new applications for DLS specifically and for 3D printing in general. What's your favorite application that you've seen so far for RPU130?
So far I have seen is the use case of like a key fob. Like you don't even think about it in general that you're using a key fob and how tough that material needs to be, but you drop it all the time, you leave it in cringes where it comes in contact with different materials and chemicals and needs to be stable with water. But an RPU130 is like a perfect use case for it, where it has the impact strength to withstand, and it can also withstand the daily use case of using it in winter versus using it during summer where the car gets hot and it also sees quite a different variance in the temperature from minus 20 to possibly 100 C.
The design freedom opened up by 3D printing is really interesting here too. I mean, you mentioned that ABS can be formulated with different ratios of its components and different additives to get different characteristics. On the 3D printing side, rather than maybe reformulating the materials on the fly, you can change aspects of the design. So you can add lattices, you can add the textures that you mentioned that really change the performance and characteristics of a part. It really opens up a lot of design space when you have these materials that let you make, you know, end-use plastic parts on 3D printers.
And it is amazing for me to see that a material, same material which is being used for a key fob versus your glasses or your sunglasses can also be used for something in for the protection for your helmets. And it all depends on how you design the material and how you want to structure it. Like if you want to lattice the parts out, it depends on the density you want to tune it in, which can give it a variety of different applications as well.
Yeah, you get to specify the performance you want at every millimeter. It's not like just picking a single, you know, material and putting it into an injection mold. So it's a cool new era for design.
And that's the freedom which 3D printing gives you. You can dial it down to a small voxel.
Ikpreet Grover is a senior research scientist at Carbon. Thanks so much for chatting with us today, Ikpreet.
Thanks, John.
This is a fascinating area that's developing really quickly. And if viewers are interested in learning more, you can visit us at carbon3d.com to learn more about our materials for digital light synthesis and subscribe to Carbon on YouTube for more of these videos where we ask 3D printing experts to go into the ins and outs of additive manufacturing.